The idea of whisky terroir has been disputed for years. Terroir, a French term from terre, the land, the climate, the soil, topography, techniques. It's a vast subject in wine, so I'll get to the point in regards to whisky with a focus on malt whisky, Scotch and Irish whisky in particular. It's the start of a good debate between cynics, science and romantics. So let's dive in there just now. Hello, Hendo here. Welcome to Is There Terroir in Whisky? In this video, we will explore the aspects influencing not the grape, but the grain spirit of whisky, malt whisky. To learn more about the drinks industry, brand marketing from a global perspective, please like this video, subscribe, but also check out hendotalks.com for some creative projects. Terroir is the basis of the French wine appellation, the d'origine contrôlée, AOC system. The climate, soil, vineyard topography, wind direction, coastal fog, grapes are very sensitive. Barley is completely different, not even a fruit, a grain. And it's also distilled after fermentation. Microbiology of fermentation in the wash, yeast, time and temperature, copper contact in the pot still, and cut point all define the spirit's character. Before I delve into finer details, let me share some thoughts. Having worked in whisky, WC educated, sat in nosing, tasting, sensory and judging panels, spent an unhealthy amount of time in the archives, science publications, collaborating with scientists, cameos at distilleries, and trampled on a few grapes in France. What I'll cover is set the scene, touching popularised whisky styles in the market, historical grains, recognise and interpret the science. In Scotland, Scotch whisky is viewed by distillers and master blenders as recipes, a house style, distinctive, recognisable in their brand portfolio. It's important to recognise this. I'll provide a wider lens on the topic to give context for whisky appreciators and how we got here. Terroir and whisky seems to represent a sense of place, or rather the creation of a sense of place over soil and slope elevation. A cornerstone of wine terroir is what the French call élevage, the wine's raising or its breeding. And I think this is important to whisky, tradition and techniques used. Now, distilled spirit is heavily influenced by the cask. So much focus now is on maturation and cask management. Modern whisky palate styles around the globe can be crudely oversimplified to peaty, ex-bourbon or heavily sherried styles, due in part to the spicification of our palates. Consumers and brands seem to be caught up in all about the wood. Historically, in Scotland, when whisky was made by farmers, cask availability depended on your status. Local shipping imports and the spirit ushkaba was enjoyed young from a living cask. Age appreciation came in the turn of the 20th century. In Aberdeenshire in the 1880s, locals like sherry kick-started pioneering distillers to create sherry cask matured Scotch. Other areas had their own preferences, wines, port or rum barrels. It's long forgotten now, but it could be classed as a 19th century terroir. Modern cask seasoning is quite different. Huge investment in casks has only happened in the last few decades. But is this sherry-drenched cask trend masking terroir? Master blenders who use finishes to brighten older spirit or give the impression of older spirit, are these techniques terroir? Elsewhere, I've been drawn to the legacy of the late Dr. Jim Swan, who encouraged international distillers in a cleaner, fruit-driven spirit with rejuvenated casks, STR, shaved, toasted and recharred to let the spirit sing. Dr. Jim Swan consulted and still inspires so many world whisky distillers. It's interesting to see how these contrasting élevages are playing out in the market just now. If you consider every spirit has a story, many believe peaty Scotch whisky holds terroir, evocative, releasing memories perhaps we didn't know. taste is memory, and many people hark back to childhood experiences, seaside or campfire, when nosing peaty whisky, tasting the difference between signature Isla distillers and then settling on a favourite style. A whisky made in Orkney grows their own barley and uses local peat to smoke that barley, so there's a sense of place and an argument for terroir and peat. The peat there is floral and fragrant, quite different from peats in other parts of Scotland, producing a unique character noticed in the final spirit. However, the subject gets complicated quickly when many distillers outsource grain and maltings, and it can even relocate island spirit within weeks of it being distilled. PPM in peaty whisky is phenol parts per million in barley grain. Distillers can select from maltsters the level they need for their recipe, like choosing the cut of a suit at Savile Row Tailor. There's not so many single estate whisky distilleries now. Then factor in the distilling technique nuances, including the cut point, how that can affect the PPM in the final spirit. I'm oversimplifying a huge number of factors, but shows just how skewed a spirit can become. Scotch only has oak for casks, but Irish and world whiskies can use hundreds of cask styles. In regards to terroir, it is much easier to say that if you compare the grain's terroir, soil, the climate, field position against a repeated process, then you can identify if the taste is different. So let's get back to the grain. Do the distinctive characteristics of crops survive fermentation and distillation into the final spirit? I've sat with agronomists, talked about thousands of barley varieties, modern trends, historical grains like Bear Barley, Concerto and Odyssey. Farmers choose to suit their landscape, consider micronutrient deficiency, reducing grain yield and quality. Ancient strain Bear Barley, a six-row barley, a landrace barley in Scotland, adapted in marginal conditions, low pH soil. But other strains are favoured for better yields today. In the wild elements of Scotland and Ireland, barley strain and the season's climate will determine the harvest outcome. The physical environment in which the barley is grown has an impact on the way the whisky made there will taste. So it's hard not to mention Mark Renye, the former CEO of Bruichladdie Distillery on Isla. He revived in 2000, bringing wine culture to whisky at Bruichladdie Distillery on Isla. He set up regional trials, traceability and provenance, terroir driven. The legacy carried on after he left. Around a quarter of their Scottish barley comes from Isla farmers, having been grown since 2004. Some are sourced island-wide, groups of farms, single farms, and some can be traced to individual fields. Barley can vary dramatically from one end of a field to another. The crop in higher slope can ripen significantly faster than on the lower ground. And what about the season? A poor spring, or cold and wet, and then a very good summer with plenty warm and sunshine, long days, coupled with regular rainfall. The lessons here built strong foundations in research, trends and improved techniques. A system of traceability and provenance would then be taken to his next venture at Waterford Distillery in Ireland in 2015. The systematic approach introduced in Ireland is quite astonishing. Waterford Distillery produces about 1 million litres annually, similar to medium-sized Scotch distilleries like Glengoyne, but what captures you is the scale of the farm collaborations, sourcing from 97 Irish farms on 19 distinct soil types, harvested and then taken to a grain cathedral. Each farm is separated, taken to the maltings and then separate distillations, and then into different casks, all meticulously recorded in a digital logistical system. They've already filled warehouses, put down thousands of casks spirit to age. Lessons from Isla. Described as milfoy, layers of flavour, each farm has vintages, nothing the same. They are not looking for consistency. Now compare what I said earlier about brands having a recipe and a house style. Each field has a passport, its name, an LPIS number, land parcel identification system, traceability, soil type, climate, field GPS, year, vintage, barley, variety, volume, yield. This has given them strong ground to work with scientists and prove specific differences. A few weeks ago, Waterford Distillery released to the press the Whisky Terroir Project, proving terroir a new make whisky spirit. The study analysed two varieties of barley, Olympus and Laureate, from 2017-2018 barley samples, micro-malted and micro-distilled in standardised laboratory conditions. Waterford worked with academics from the US, Scotland, Greece, Belgium and Ireland, including Tegas Food Research Centre, Enterprise Ireland, Minchmalt and Scotland's leading whisky laboratory. This study has clearly demonstrated variations in the contribution of the aroma, active volatiles and sensory attributes in these new make spirits, and reflects changes in barley growth in relation to environmental elements, including soil nutrients and prevailing seasonal weather patterns, and therefore reveals a terroir effect. Further research is required to better understand the specific environmental impact on barley growth, and expect to publish further findings in 2020 as the spirit matures. Now, I don't work for Waterford or get paid for this. I just recognise achievements when I see it. Scientific research is something I know about. I spent 2 years collaborating with Glasgow University Polyomics for science festivals and whisky and gin science events, identifying aromatic volatile compounds from gas chromatography, mass spectrometry, GC and MS for short. We presented findings but never took it to publication. Getting science published is quite an ordeal, and academic politics, years of research and specific conditions can have to be assessed. The takeaway that we learned in identifying mass spectrometry compounds is you still very much need the human touch and sensory identification. I am used to evaluating thousands of samples of spirit in my role. Approving terroir and whisky new make spirit has of course come with cynicism from some commentators online. It's the world we live in, so people can dismiss things immediately, instant gratification, not appreciating the lengthy process needed to prove science publication, the sheer effort on many fronts, cooperation, dedication and analysis. What I learned from years of public presentations internationally to large audiences is I research hundreds of science papers to provide the content to share. Science is at its most potent when it's shared. Vital knowledge not shared does a disservice to a lifetime of study and education. This Waterford Terroir Project is just the beginning, not the end of the matter. They'll go on to find new things and use the learnings for other projects like the Renegade Rum Distillery on Grenada. I'll put a link to a rum terroir video up here. But open access publishing, we can all learn. Distillers and many trade people can be inspired by this. A platform for future generations to learn from and have better understanding of the world we live in. So, is there terroir in whisky? Hell yeah. Barley from a specific place has been traced all the way through to final spirit, showing individual differences under lab conditions and in peer review journal. So let's see how the conversation grows after the spirit maturation. Next time you quickly scan science findings, remember there's a huge amount of work behind it. I've just been comparing drams of Waterford Single Farm Origin Series Ballycalavan 1.1, 1.2, a few bare barley Scotch whisky expressions like Arran and Bruichladdie, also Bruichladdie's terroir vintages, Isla Barley Farm bottlings. I fully expect Waterford to grow their Irish whisky vintages based on terroir. These are not the only terroir whiskies out there. I believe in others, and the debate will linger on. So tell us what you think of terroir in whisky. I think I'll add more videos here because there's a lot more to cover. And if you're interested in whisky projects, contact us at hendotalks.com. As always, welcome your comments. I hope this was useful to you in some way. And until next time, thanks very much for watching.